Let's just do it in the morning.
Or, you know, let's, I can open up the, this. Number 92, and anything like 92, where we represent a real-world situation, and then we ask the question like, we ask a question like, the rate at which H is changing. Can we ask questions like that? What are we talking about? The derivative. Okay? It's always the rate at which something is changing. Just to give you a quick, simple graphical example. If this is my distance, that says distance, and this is my time, and I do something like this, what was I doing here? Like, I'm in my car, I'm driving along, what's happening if this is like, if distance zero is like my house? Okay, I'm getting farther away. Yeah. That's as, about as basic as it gets. The distance here and the distance here, well, this distance is bigger than this one, I'm getting farther away. A positive direction, whatever that means. To the right or but I'm getting farther away in whatever direction I called positive. And now what am I doing?
Coming back.
Coming back towards my house. And now I am not at my house. I am away from my house. And I am now doing what?
What were you
going
doing?
Back? Away. I was driving away and I forgot something and then I remembered, oh, I did bring it. And then I was going, and then I, no, I really did forget it. And then I came back to my house. Okay. Actually, I took a trip quite like this the other day. I was driving, any trip like this, it's my wife's, don't tell her that. She called and she's like, oh, why don't you go to, like, meet us in Missoula. Okay, I'll meet you in Missoula. Oh no, I come to Missoula, we'll just meet you at the house. Okay, I'll turn around. Oh no, let's just meet in Missoula. And I turned around three times, I think. So that was fun. It looked a lot like this. But anyway, if I look at any point at the instantaneous slope, and I'm looking at the rate of change. Remember, if I look at the slope of this graph, ooh, that doesn't look very tangent-y. Tangential. So if I look at the tangent line, look at the slope of the tangent line, it tells me something about how fast I'm going, my velocity. If I look at the slope, whatever it is, it's a change in y, which is distance, miles, I don't know, whatever the distance is. It's a change in y and the change in x. Rise over run is the change in y versus the change in x. That's the rate of change of whatever y is measured in versus whatever x is measured in. Distance over time. So the slope of this tangent line is the distance over time is feet per second, miles per hour. It's some kind of a velocity. Here it's positive, right? I'm driving positive. I have a positive velocity. Okay. Now, as we start to look at how does the velocity change over time? Well, now we're talking about acceleration. But my speed is big here and it's smaller relatively to what it was before. So what am I doing? I'm slowing down. I'm moving forward, but my foot's on the brake. I'm slowing myself down until I do what?
Stop.
And now I'm doing what? I'm turning around. It's a small slope. This slope is bigger in magnitude, right? So what am I doing? this direction. Going the other way. Negative direction. Faster and faster. Right? In the other direction. I've turned around and I'm traveling faster and faster in the other direction until I get to about here when I'm going as fast as I'll ever be going, at least in this interval. And then I start to slow down again if, you know, really I'm speeding up, right? Like bigger velocities, positive, getting closer to a positive velocity. And then I'm speeding up again, going the fastest I'll go in that interval, slowing down, slowing down, slowing down, stopping, right? The slope is the rate of change. How is something changing? The slope tells us that. What tells us the slope? The derivative, right? In calculus, a function called the derivative tells us the slope wherever, whenever we want. It's pretty stupendous. Okay, so we're talking about rate of change, we're talking about slope, we're talking about the derivative. So let's kind of just jump ahead to the question and keep in mind what we're trying to figure out. Find the rate at which h is changing with respect to theta.
Okay.
So let's see. So this line is shooting off to the horizon. If you imagine you're on a satellite, you're very, very far away from space, and you look out, you can see the curvature of space. And if you look right across the top of the Earth, right, you see the Earth from your perspective. You're so far away, you can see that it's curved. And if you look just straight out from your perspective, right, straight across there, you imagine it's going into the board, we're shooting a line across the horizon. The angle between the horizon and the line that goes to the center of the Earth, that's what theta is. And if theta is changing, we're always shooting to the horizon and we're always shooting to the center of the Earth. So if theta is changing, I must be changing my height, right? There's just no other way to get around that. I can't. The only way to stay the same height or distance away from the surface of the Earth and change theta would be to change the places that I measure theta by. If I'm measuring to these same two places, then my h must also be changing. So that's what's happening. So as the angle changes, gets bigger and gets smaller, h must change. What if they get smaller? What would h do? Would it get bigger or smaller, do you think? Theta. This angle right here. Would h get bigger or smaller? Bigger. And you can think of it either way. It might make more sense to say I'm changing h, so theta is changing. But it's asking for the reverse relationship. If theta is changing for some reason, how is that affecting h? And if theta is changing at a constant rate, then h probably isn't changing at a constant rate. Right? You know what I mean?
If this is increasing at a 1 degree per minute or something like that.
Anyway. So, if I want to know the rate at which h is changing with respect to theta, what am I looking for? The change in what versus the change in what? The change in h versus the change in theta. Change in h versus the change in theta. Right? And that represents a slope. It represents derivative. It represents a few different things. Okay. So here's deal. This is like our y, like our output. And this is like our x, like our input. Okay? This is the deciding factor, is the independent variable, and here's our dependent variable. So what we want to do, if we want d h d theta, we need some function that will be like y equals something with x, but in this case, h equals some function of theta. Right? Okay? I'm sure all of this stuff is just saying what I just said. R is the radius of the Earth, so this is R, and also this is R. This is h, this is your distance from the surface. This distance is kind of doesn't really mean anything. It's the distance from you on the satellite to the horizon. And that's what that diagram is showing. So first we want to show that h is equal to R cosecant theta minus 1. We want to show that if I know theta, and I know r, I can plug them in there and that'll tell me h. Prove that h can be found this way. Okay. Well, We know our trig. At least we pretend to know. Yes?
So, cosecant, that's the opposite of sine, right?
It's the reciprocal.
Reciprocal. So, yeah, so would it be hypotenuse over the opposite angle?
Which one's the hypotenuse?
The hypotenuse is r plus h.
Okay, so r plus h is the hypotenuse of this triangle.
Hypotenuse, and then over the opposite, which would be r.
Okay.
So, that would be the cosecant theta.
Yes.
And then, like, and then you just put that in for cosecant theta minus 1 to r.
What do you mean by that?
You kind of just plug it in for cosecant in the, or cosecant theta in the equation.
Oh, so you can just take this and plug it in and then show that this simplifies to h?
Yeah.
Okay. Or we can just take this guy, solve for h, and then just have it be the same as that.
Do you?
That's what I prefer, because it kind of tests my trig and solving for a variable skills, right? So, you heard it from Chance. You can plug it in there and see that, like, this simplifies down to h, right? Well, let's just rewrite this, solve for h. How would we solve for h in this equation? But did everybody see what Chance did?
Yeah.
You could have done it with anything. We could have said sine of theta equals r over r plus h. Could have done that. And those are probably your best choices, because any other trig ratio would involve other sides. It really has no significance in how long it is. You always want to involve the variables that you're given or that they talk about that you think they'll give you information about at some point. You don't want to involve random variables that don't seem to have anything to do with anything.
Trust me, it's all I've been looking at.
Okay, so how would we solve for h?
Multiply by r.
Let's get rid of that r in the denominator. I like that idea. Multiply by r. So we have r plus h equals r times cosecant of theta.
Okay.
Are we using Chance's equation?
We are. Okay. We're solving for h. We're using Chance's equation, but not his approach.
Okay.
His approach was to plug this in for cosecant of theta.
Okay.
I'm saying that's too easy. Let's just solve for h.
Okay.
Let's challenge ourselves. But perfectly valid. Now, if they said write h in terms of theta, or write a in terms of theta in r, or as a function of theta, I mean, they didn't give you this, and you have to write it yourself. This is going to be more common as time goes on. We're going to have to write these ourselves. So when we subtract r, I heard, really easy, r cosecant theta minus r, how do I make this look like that?
Factor out an r.
Factor out an r. I have no idea how nice it is to hear someone say factor out an r after teaching a bunch of algebra. They don't know about that, really, so it's nice to be able to just drop that so easily. So it's true. We wrote a relationship between theta, h, and r. We rewrote it so that it looks like this. And if we had written the sine of theta equals r over r plus h, so be at some point we would wind up probably with a 1 over the sine somewhere in that equation returning to cosecant. All right. So part A is done. And it says, find the rate at which h is changing with respect to theta when theta equals 30 degrees. Remember, we just talked about this. The rate at which h is changing with respect to theta, that's dh d theta. The change in h with respect to the change in theta. In other words, the calculus word for that that starts with d? The derivative. We need to take the derivative of this with respect
to
theta. When we say respect to theta, we mean that's the variable, that's like x. That's the input variable, the independent variable. And always the with respect to is right there, the denominator of the slope. So let's extend this down. So if I take the derivative of h with respect to theta, I can just write dh d theta, right? Or I could have called h of theta, right? We're all familiar with function notation. It doesn't make us so that do we call it h prime of theta? Or maybe I didn't call it h of theta. I just called it h, and so I could call it h prime. All of these names, all these different notations mean exactly the same thing. The derivative of h. This one doesn't quite communicate everything, so it's just the derivative of the function called h. Okay, well, what's the other variable though? It's theta. So this one communicates that information. So does this. H prime of theta is a function of theta. Okay, so we're going to take the derivative of h with respect to theta. Before we try to take this derivative, here I'm gonna give this to you guys to do. I'm just gonna point this out. What does r represent?
Radius of the
earth. Radius of the earth. Is the radius of the earth changing a lot? Not a lot. A little bit. We have meteor dust falling on us every year and that kind of stuff, and then we're also losing things that we send off to Mars. But it's just not changing all that much. So R is a what?
Constant.
Basically a constant. So, you know, if you want to help you see what's going on here, you can just replace R with what the radius of the Earth actually is. Okay, you don't really have to. Let's say it's 3,000. It doesn't even matter. I'm sure it's 3,000 in some units. Right?
Well, it says assume r equals 3,960.
Oh, so it does say that.
Yeah, it says the bottom.
So we could just change r to 3,960? Okay?
Yep.
Now take the derivative of that with 3,960 replacing r. Remember we got that constant multiple rule?
Yep.
Or use the product rule and treat 3,960 as a constant function.
So you'll figure out pretty quickly what happens when you do that.
The constant multiple rule says if I have a function times a constant and I want to know its derivative, then I just really need to take the constant times the derivative of this thing, right? This part's just a constant, just a number times its function. If you take a little bit to think about it, it would make sense if the derivative of just this part tells me the slope of this function, like cosecant of theta minus 1 equals y, right? Then if I take that function and multiply by 3,960, then all the slopes will be 3,960 times steeper. Right? So anyway, 3,960 times the derivative of this function. What's the derivative of the cosecant?
1 over sine cosine, then you have to take the quotient.
That's a good idea. But also, we know the derivative of sine is cosine. Derivative of cosine is negative sine. We also know the derivative of tangent is secant squared. Derivative of secant is secant tangent. We also know the derivative of cosecant. Chance?
Negative cosecant cotangent.
Negative cosecant cotangent. Cosecant cotangent. Okay. Minus the derivative of 1?
0.
0, so done. So what does this function tell me? What's that?
Derivative of h of theta.
The derivative of h of theta. Okay, h of theta is one that tells me my height at any given theta. H prime of theta tells me how fast h is changing. If I know how fast theta is changing. Once you tell me how fast theta is changing, then I can, well, actually, once you just tell me what theta is, okay, it tells me how fast h is changing depending on how big theta is. Theta is 30, so h prime of theta of 30, 3,960 times the negative cosecant of 30 degrees times the cosine of 30 degrees Oh, sorry, cotangent to 30 degrees. Don't put it in your calculator, people. What's the cosecant of 30 degrees?
Oh.
1 over sine. Sine of 30. Sine of 30, no. It's 1 half. One half. Negative 1 half. No, wait. 1 over 1 half. So negative 2. Times, what's the cotangent of 30 degrees?
1 over root 3.
1 over root 3. Root 3 over 3?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have negative 7,000. Times the square root of 3 over 3. Actually, this is divisible by 3. So, what's negative 7,920 divided by 3? Whatever it is, times root of 3.
Oh, 9. 2640.
Oh, am I right? Yeah. Okay. 2640 root 3. Units of this number.
Miles.
Just miles? It's how fast something's changing, right?
Miles per degree.
Degree, yeah. Because we plugged in 30 degrees, yeah. It's changing at 30 miles per degree. Okay, so like at that instant, when theta is 30 degrees, if I were to give it one more degree, I should expect to go 30 miles farther away from the Earth. It's kind of a weird rate of change because it's in terms of theta. Does that? We did that. But then the thing is, once that theta changes one more degree, how fast my distance is changing away from the Earth has also changed. You know what I'm saying? As theta gets smaller, I'm moving away from the Earth less and less. More and more slowly. Or is it more and more quickly? As theta gets smaller and smaller and smaller.
As you get smaller, you go farther away from the Earth.
Farther away, but are you going away from the Earth faster or slower than you were? We would have to do something else. We won't worry about that right now. Okay, 92, that was that. Any other questions?
Oh, yeah. 27.
Okay. 27, any others?
It's not a specific number, but when we were gone, we went over the velocity thing. We just thought.
The velocity thing?
Oh, 16 t squared minus sufficient velocity.
Yeah.
Teach it to you?
Yes, please.
Where did that come from?
It was in
2.2. It's just a vertical motion formula for field
objects. Yeah.
It's on page 172.
Oh,
right.
Okay. All right. Let me jump to 27 here, and then we'll go back to that. That sounds good to everybody? 7x equals x times 1 minus 4 over x plus. This all depends on how we want to approach this. If we just go for it, then we're going to have to use what? The product rule, because we have a function times a function. You know what we're going to do at some point when we're doing that product rule is when you go to take the derivative of this, you're going to have to use the quotient motion. Yeah. Okay, well. Here's another option. Before we even start, what if we did this? Anybody do that? No? we do it that way, is that better?
Yes.
What do I get rid of?
Okay.
I get rid of the need for the product rule. So either way, I'm gonna go with this one. Okay. What's the derivative of x?
One.
Let's take the derivative of this quotient. I need the quotient rule. Okay. Low d I. Derivative of the high.
Four
minus high.
4x d low.
What's the derivative of the denominator?
101
over the square of what's below. And we can clean this up. We got 4x plus 12 minus 4x. X plus 3 squared. That's 1 minus 12 over x plus 3 squared. That's x plus 3 squared plus 12 over x plus 3 squared. This is getting a common denominator for the 1. It's x plus 3 squared over x plus 3 squared.
1.
Right? So if I didn't have a common denominator, add together.
In the second step.
Here?
The,
here.
Up 1. That 4, is it 4x or is it 4?
Well, I distribute the 4 to the x.
I guess up one more. Is the top supposed to be 4x or 4?
I distributed this x.
Oh, okay.
So in mine,
I didn't distribute the x.
If you don't do that, you have to use the product rule.
Yeah.
And we can do that real quick. Okay.
Sorry, I was just confused by my own work.
So we'll go u v prime plus v prime u. Okay, u v prime. Okay, so I'm going to have to take the derivative of this, which means as part of that, I'm going to have to take the derivative of this quotient.
Okay.
So derivative of 1 is 0. Derivative, okay, so it's going to be negative. Derivative of 4 over x plus 3, well, it's low di. That's x plus 3 times 0 minus high d low 1 over the square of what's below. X minus x plus 3 over x plus 3 squared.
What about the root of 4 go over?
What's that?
Minus 4 up top. X minus x plus 3
is just 0.
Oh, I misread that. Minus 1. I thought that was 4 times 0. It's 4 times 1.
What do you mean? So it's only be minus 4.
What's that?
X plus 3 times 0. It's just going to be
0. Oh, I had it backwards. And then you just erase all that stuff.
So it's just going to be negative 4.
So just negative 4.
Right, okay.
Okay, does that mean we're done?
No.
No, what did we just do?
Quotient rule.
We did the b prime. Yeah, we just did the first, like, we're done with the first half of the product rule. Because there's also plus the u prime. Well, b, that's easy. 1 minus 4 over x plus 3 plus 3 times the derivative of x. One. So plus 1 minus 4 over x plus 3. You can get common denominators for everything, and you can combine it, and it'll all be the same as this.
Where'd you get the x plus 3 squared on the numerator?
I just changed this.
Yeah.
I got common denominators. So I turned that into x plus 3 squared over x plus 3 squared.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Cool.
Got common denominators, and just put together the. This is a minus, this is minus.
Yeah.
On that? Okay, so you said that the position function for
vertical motion.
What about that?
What?
Do you want to know?
So what are variables?
Oh! What do they stand for? So in S of t equals negative 4.9 t squared plus, or no, you're talking about?
Literally the same thing. It's different.
Different units.
Yeah.
Yeah, so this would be meters. 4.9 t squared plus v not t plus, if you make a joke now, you'll be not the first person to make it. S not. Okay? If you make a joke about S not, you'll be not the first person. Not very original. So we have negative 4.9 squared, 4.9 t squared. T is time. T is time here. V not. When we say not, means initial. So the initial velocity. So if I throw something, or if I let something go vertically, throw it down, it's got an initial negative velocity. If I throw it up, it's got an initial positive velocity. And then this guy right here, the acceleration of gravity, will take care of either making you go faster down or stopping it from going up and then you start to come back down. And S not is, S is the position. We had an Italian student last year who told us that, I can't remember the word she said, but the Italian word for like position starts with S. So that's why it has its roots in some other language. S represents the position, the initial position. So if I'm on the ground, my initial position is zero. If I'm on the top of a building, my initial position is however high that building is. Okay. So that's all of those things mean. And the other one, negative 16 t squared plus, well, the rest of it is the same, v naught t plus s naught. That is just in feet per second rather than meters per second.
So you just plug the initial velocity in for v
naught. Initial velocity and an initial position, you plug those in. And then you start messing around with time.
Gotcha.
I definitely
got
that. Yeah, I did too.
Yeah.
If you don't get a time warp plus, so like, like on the quiz, it was where is the thing at 100 feet?
Well, so if I want to know the velocity, if I want to know the velocity at a given time, I need a velocity function. This is not a velocity function. Where do I get a velocity function from a position function? Velocity is how fast the distance is changing with respect to time. My keyboard.
Okay.
So, if I take the derivative of s, well, s is the position with respect to time. So the rate of change of s with respect to time, change of position versus time, that's velocity. Okay. So, then we take the derivative, we get the velocity function, and any t we put in there, we'll find out how fast. But if I tell you how fast is it moving, so we'll take s prime of t, that's equal to negative 9.8 plus v naught, right? Because whatever I'm playing for v. What's that? T, yes, very good. T plus v naught, that's it. And then the derivative of an s, whatever that number was, is still zero. And so if I say how fast is it moving at 3 seconds. Well, I plug 3 in there, I'm done. But if I say how fast is it moving once it has, you know, when it's at a height of 12 feet or whatever. Well, then I'd have to go back to my position function, figure out at what time it was at 12 feet. Does that make sense? I would put 12 here. Because anything I put in here for t is going to tell me how high off the ground or how far away, well, how it is a falling object, so how high off the ground it is. Okay. So if I plug some stuff in here, s of t, let's see, it was moving at an initial velocity of 2 meters per second, and I was on a building that was 200 feet tall. Plug all that stuff in.
What are we solving for? Like where it is at a certain point in time?
Well, I'm asking you how fast is it going once it is fallen 50 feet or whatever. Well, that I can't really know that from this function. I need time for this function. So here, I'll say, if it's fallen 50 feet, how high is it? 150 feet. So I'll say 150 feet. I'm telling you what position to have, and then I solve for t. It's a quadratic equation. Quadratic formula takes care of it. Okay? Okay. Then, like, when I do that, I solve for t. Now I know t, and I can plug t.
Thank you.
gonna say, did you say 19? What'd you say?
Yeah, 13 or 19, or both.
I signed 19? Okay, I just didn't have a circle. So, they're different. So, let's do 19 real quick, because it's the easiest one. You got y equals x squared plus 2x over 3. Well, it seems like this is a quotient, and you need to use the quotient function, right? But if you do the quotient rule, then at one point you're going to take the derivative of 3, and it'll be 0. It seems like it's kind of a waste. Like, one of your terms is 0. It seems like there should have been an easier way, right? It's kind of a waste. So there is an easier way. We can rewrite this as 1 third x squared plus 2 thirds x. Right? Just divide both of those terms by 3. Now, it's just the sum of two functions. We don't need the quotient rule or anything, which is the power rule. And the power rule again. So we get 2 thirds x to the first plus 2 thirds times x to the 0 times 1. So sometimes you can just rewrite things. Even if you had like x squared plus 2x plus 3. Over x, even if it was like that. Because we just take each of these things and divide by x. X squared divided by x, x, 2x divided by x, 2, 3 divided by x, 3 over x. I'm just going to rewrite this one. X plus 2 plus 3x to the negative 1. Now it's 1 plus 0 plus negative 3x to the negative 2, 1 minus 3 over x squared. So we can use that trick, but once if it were like x squared plus 2x plus 3 over x minus 5, now we should go with the quotient rule. Yeah?
With 19, would it be okay to have multiplied by 3?
To have multiplied by 3?
Just to get rid of the denominator. So you get 3x squared plus 6x.
By 3, I mean just multiply the numerator by 3?
Oh, it would have to be by, oh yeah, I see what I did wrong. That would be 3x plus 6x over 9.
It would be.
Yeah, that's wrong. Okay.
You could do something kind of funny and multiply both sides of this equation by 3. But then you'd have 3y equals x squared plus 2x. You can take the derivative of both sides still. You can take the derivative of this, it would just be 3y prime equals 2x plus 2, but then you have to solve for y prime. Divide by 3. And the same thing. So it's back. 13. Instructions here just say find f prime. So we can find f prime any way we want. One way would be this is a product of two functions. Here's a function, we can call this one u, and this one v. U prime v times v prime u. Or we can take and write it like this: 2x to the fifth. 3, 6 minus 3x to the, well, hold on. I think it's all in my head here. 5x to the third, negative 6, so negative x to the third, oh, I missed a fourth there, plus 3x to the fourth. Minus 9
x squared minus 15x.
Okay. See what I did there? Just multiply the super parentheses together. And now, no product rule, no quotient rule needed. Let's take the derivative straight across. 10x to the fourth. I'm going to take this one next. 12x cubed minus 3x squared minus 18x minus 15. And that can be the derivative too. Okay, it's a quotient, so we need to use a quotient rule. Well, you don't have to, but we will. We will use a quotient rule. Here we go. So di, that's 2 cosine x times the derivative of this. Well, the derivative of this is, oh, you know what, hold on, let's back it up. Let's rewrite this as y equals 3 halves times 1 minus sine x over cosine x. Okay? Is that cool? And then we have the constant multiple rule that says I just have to take 3 halves times the derivative of this thing, and that will be the derivative that I'm looking for. So that 3 halves, I'll just carry through here. Low cosine x times the derivative of this. What's the derivative of 1 minus sine x? Negative cosine. Cosine x. So that's low di minus?
High di low.
High di low. What's the derivative of cosine?
Negative sine.
Sine x over cosine squared. 3 halves times negative cosine squared x minus 1 plus, or no, I need to distribute that sine. Okay. So let's see, we get sine x times 1, negative sine x times 1 is negative sine x, so that's plus sine x. Negative sine x times negative sine x is positive sine squared x times negative is negative sine squared x. Over cosine squared x. I'm going to take the negative cosine squared and the negative sine squared, and I'm going to make it negative cosine squared x plus sine squared x plus sine x over cosine squared x. Is that all right with everybody? And what's cosine squared x plus sine squared x? One. 3 halves times, well, this is 1 and this is a negative, so it's negative 1 plus sine x over cosine squared x. And just, depending on, I mean, that's it. That's true, this is true, this is correct. Depending on who you ask, it might simplify this as 3 halves minus 1 over cosine squared x plus sine x over cosine squared x, which makes this, what's 1 over cosine? Secant. So this is secant squared x plus sine x over cosine x times 1 over cosine x What's sine over cosine? Tangent, so this is the tangent x times, what's 1 over cosine? Secant x, secant squared x, 3 halves, minus secant squared x plus secant tangent, factor out secant for both of those if you want. I don't know, just keep on going and changing it, changing it, changing it. I'll bet the book does something like that, but you know what the book actually probably does? Takes this. Does this. Y equals 3 halves. You know, it's multiplying here. 1 over cosine x minus sine x over cosine x. Splits it up like that before you take the derivative. 3 halves times, what's 1 over cosine? Secant x minus tangent x. And then take the derivative of that, which doesn't require particle or quotient rule or anything. It's just 3 halves times secant x tangent x minus secant squared x.
Are you there?
Yeah.
So why does the 3 halves not get derived at all constant?
It's the constant multiple rule, which is if I have a constant multiple, a constant multiplied by a function, then the derivative of the whole thing is just that constant times the derivative of this thing. Okay, let's think about this. Y equals x squared. Okay? Well, the derivative is 2x, right? Now let's look at y equals 5x squared. How does the graph of 5x squared look compared to x squared?
It's skinnier.
5 times steeper. I mean, that. We've been saying that since algebra 2, and now it's true. Like, we see the truth behind it, okay? This is y equals x squared, you know, like this. If that's y equals x squared, this is y equals 5x squared, right? If we go to this x, and we go to the same x over here, how does this slope compare to this slope, do you think? Sort of 5 times steeper. We've been, I taught you to say steeper 2 years ago, and now in calculus, it's truer than it's ever been. This all the tangent lines are 5 times steeper than all these tangent lines at the same x. Except, well, it's still 5 times. 5 times 0.
5 times the greater 0.
Yeah. So y prime here equals 2x. This y prime equals 5 times 2x. Right? 5 times bigger than all these slopes, so 10x. So the constant multiple just tags along throughout the derivative taking process. Okay? Here's what we're going to do. We're going to delay the quiz again. Because it's more likely that we'll be able to learn the chain rule in the amount of time left, then we will be able to finish this quiz.
They get to learn chain rule.
Okay.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
It's a good thing.
Well, chain rule's great. Try to square it. Just do it. Multiply it out. Multiply one of these times another one of these. Right?
Yeah.
Absolutely, you can do that. That's how I would do it if I didn't know about the chain rule. Okay, we just multiply them together. You get x to the 6th, blah, 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 blah. And then take the derivative, and it would be really easy. Okay? So I'm going to say, you know, I left as an exercise for the reader, which is a common term in math books. You can multiply it out. You can take the derivative. It's not that complicated. You don't need to watch me do it. Another idea.
I did that, and then I took the product rule of that, and I kind of noticed that it was just the same thing. So would it just be the derivative of that times 2?
The derivative of that, of what?
X cubed plus 3x squared.
X cubed plus 3x squared, the derivative of that.
Because in this thing, it's the derivative of that times that, like, not derivatized, and then plus that again, so it would just be two times.
So many that.
Oh, so you did the product rule.
Yeah.
And then you
I just noticed that it was just like, they're just both the same numbers, basically, so it'd just be, and then they're adding together, so it'd just be that two times, two times.
So you got times, times, this, plus another one of these.
Whoa.
Is that what you're saying?
He's saying that when you take the product rule, it's going to be the exact, like, this thing plus this thing are going to be the exact same thing, so it's just going to be this times 2. So,
the
like, f
of
x times g of x times 2. Or g prime of x.
Oh.
Kendra, you forgot with that.
You're saying when you did the product rule, you got this.
Yeah, and then
times
just do
this.
3, or x3, yeah, and then just times 2 for the entire thing.
But you, what you actually got was another one of these, plus.
Yeah, yeah, plus. So,
so
times 2.
Yes.
See?
Good observation.
Not so cool.
Cool.
Now understand my chain rule works.
Plus 3x squared.
I didn't know that before.
To the third.
It's going to be 3x.
Rough.
Well, yeah, almost.
Really?
Well, here is the challenge behind using the product rule for this. Remember that we had three functions before. So if we did this, x cubed plus 3x squared times x cubed plus 3x squared times another one, x cubed plus 3x squared. We have three functions times each other. And if we want to use the product rule, which is a good idea, we're going to have to treat this as one function. And at first, we're going to treat this all as another function. Remember when we did three functions?
Yes.
We did. I was looking at the notes just a little while ago.
Yeah.
So this is u and this is v. And then we need to do u v prime, then v prime requires a chain rule itself. So it becomes bigger than you think. But what it actually is, well, you'll think you are really close, but I mean, really, you're not that close. Kind of. But if you think about it, we know the derivative of this, right?
Yeah.
Because James just told us if we do the product rule, we're going to get just like this times its derivative, and again, right? So like this would be 2 times x cubed plus 3x squared times 3x squared plus 6x. Oh, yeah, 6x. And then we could use that, and then, But, you know, what happens when I take it to the 4th power and the 5th power and the 6th power? Like, it just becomes...
It's like a scale of magnitude.
Yeah, scales of magnitude, orders of magnitude. So, here's what you should notice. Well, here. I'll tell you what the derivative is. It's 3 times x cubed plus 3x squared times 3x squared plus 6x. Close to what you said, right? Except for there's that guy. X cubed plus 3x squared to the 4th power. What do you think?
Y times 4 times
y prime.
Y prime 4 times x cubed plus z squared plus cubed plus y times 3x squared plus 6x squared.
Hey, let's turn that now.
Oh, okay.
So good. It's like it seems to fit a pattern. But it actually is just stops there.
Oh, yeah, so it's always going to end in 3x squared plus 6x.
So it's going to end in the derivative of just the...
Yeah.
How would you say then? What is that?
The inside.
What we need to start looking at is, well, we need to look at these functions as compositions of other functions, of of several functions. Remember compositions of functions when I put f of g of x up in a function inside a function? Right? So we have to start breaking down which function is on the outside and which function is on the inside. And maybe what function is inside of that function and maybe what function is inside of that function. Okay. So in this case, what is the outside function?
Something
to the fourth power. Now what's the derivative of something to the fourth power? Four something to the third is the derivative of something to the fourth. Well, that's exactly what the derivative of this is. Four something to the third. Then we look inside. What's inside? What's the inside function? That's the inside function. So times the derivative of the inside function. And then once you've gotten down to a function that's not a composition, it's not a function inside a function, it's just a plain old function of x that we're used to, then you're done. You multiply by that derivative and you're done. Right, so let's do something super similar and see how it's going in your brains. X to the 13th power, the derivative would be 13x to the 12th power, right? Except for now, x is not just x, it's some other function. So when we get done doing this part of it, we've got to unpack the inside function, multiply by that derivative. We have 13 times this function, just leave it alone. Don't try and take the derivative of that yet. 12, then times 15x to the 4th minus 14x to the 1st. We're done. I mean, imagine trying to use the product rule on, or try to multiply out this, even with the binomial theorem, which is that triangle that we write out, and then we'd have to go to the 13th row, and we find all the coefficients, but then part of those terms would be like squaring 3 or taking 7 to the 12th power, or something like that. It would be a headache. Now, it's super easy. Yeah, kind of, but you're doing the same thing that was the first time we do. So let's look at this guy. This works for, I mean, we are just skyrocketing through the knowledge of calculus and derivatives taking. And we first started with really simple functions that we could use the difference quotient on, right? I mean, try to use the difference quotient on the thing we just did. Crazy, or even the product rule, the quotient rule. It's too much. It's unreasonable. We're learning these rules. We're taking patterns and we are taking advantage of them. The pattern, the chance notice, you know, you just get two of those things, so it's two times that thing. We're able to take really complicated derivatives. And I'm telling you, the chain rule now, it works for any function in a function, any composition of functions. So any function that you know the derivative of, that has a function inside of it, that you know the derivative of, that has a function inside of it, that you know the derivative of, if you go down multiple levels, you can take the derivative hacking all of that. So let's try this one. I want you to just take a crack at it. Remember, take the derivative of the outside, okay? Leaving the inside alone. Then come out here, multiply by the derivative of the inside. And just keep going. As long as there's a function inside the function you just took the derivative of, keep going. Okay. Break it down. Maybe you will have done exactly what I'm about to do, or maybe you didn't. Okay. Hopefully you didn't get cosine of 2 of x. Okay, that's not what I've described using the chain rule. What's the outside function?
Sine.
The sine. What's the derivative of the sine?
Cosine.
Okay, so we just addressed the outside function. And as long as we're like working on an outside function, we do not need to worry about the inside. Okay? So y prime starts with cosine of x squared, not 2x. Okay, now look, we took the derivative. Oh, look at that thing that's inside there. It's not x. It's not just x. It's x squared, so we need to multiply the derivative of the inside. What's the inside function? X squared is the derivative of x squared. 2x. That's it. Let's go three levels of functions within functions. Let's do the cosine of, actually, let's do the cosine squared of x to the third. Alright. First thing you need to recognize is that, what does cosine squared mean? Huh? Cosine times cosine, or cosine of x cubed squared times itself. That's what cosine squared means. Just a reminder, you've been told that a lot of times, I'm sure. But. All right, so if cosine squared means cosine of the thing squared times itself, then we write it like this and we see, there's the outside function. What's the most outside function?
Power
to the power of 2. What is the derivative of something to the power of 2?
2.
2 times the thing to the first power. 2 times cosine of x to the third to the first power. I don't know. So 2 cosine of x cubed. Okay, what was inside that square function?
Cosine
of something. What's the derivative of cosine of something?
Negative
sine of
that. X cubed.
We still have the thing I just took the derivative of. It doesn't just, it's not just of x. It's of x cubed. So I have to take the derivative of that and multiply.
2x.
3.
Yeah.
So we could do negative 6x squared cosine x cubed sine x cubed. As long as there's another function within the function you just took the derivative of, just keep unpacking it like a function inception or a Russian nesting dolls.
Isn't there a name for those that you told us last year?
It takes practice.
Russian nesting dolls.
Practice.
Nesting
dolls.
It's like starts with a B.
Because he took the
negative. Oh, negative's here.
That's
oh, yeah. That makes a lot more sense. Nothing happens to this at all when we're dealing with the
the next one. Okay.
So y prime then is equal to, first we deal with the 1/2 power. So that would be times 1/2, all the same stuff, sine of x squared plus 2/5 to the -1/2. All right, so that's the outsidest outside function.
Outside.
just inside that is what?
Sine.
The sine function. The sine function. That's all we're dealing with. We don't worry about what's inside that yet. Which is what?
Cosine.
Cosine of all the same stuff, x squared plus 2 to the fifth. Okay, so that's the derivative of the next layer. Okay, inside of the cosine function is what?
To
the fifth. Yeah, something to the fifth. Deal with that by doing 5 times the thing plus 2 to the fourth power times. Well, what's inside that? The derivative of the thing that's inside is 2x. So the thing inside is x squared plus 2, derivative of x squared plus 2? 2x. Now, that x squared plus 2, that thing we just took the derivative of? Normal function. Like we wouldn't have batted an eye at it yesterday. X squared plus 2, derivative is 2x, we're done. We don't need to keep taking derivative, there's no inside function. That's one of the challenges that people seem to come across is they think like, okay, 2x and the derivative of that and the derivative, you don't just keep taking the derivative. Once you have taken the derivative of the innermost function, multiply, you're done. So multiply by 2 and then by 1 and then by 0. That'd be no good. And you just unpack it, right? It's not that big a deal. It looks messy and think about what this is. Just think about it for a second. You have this function which, who knows what the graph of this thing looks like? It looks nuts. But in about 37 seconds, we now have a function that will tell us what? The slope of the tangent line at any point on this insane looking, must be graph. It must be an insane looking graph. This function tells us the slope at any x value. That crazy graph. That didn't take very long to find. Pretty amazing. So divide by negative 7, y equals negative 5. That means not just y is negative 5, but x is 0, right? For that point, that's how we find that point. Negative 5 on the y-axis.
Oh, yeah.
And we do the same thing, but we plug in 0 for y, and we get this really easy equation to solve. X is equal to 7. Well, we know that these points all together are going to make a line. Right? There's a point on the line, there's a point on the line, so all the other points between them must be in a straight line, and continue that straight line to the left, right.
We grade these ones out of 5, right?
Right.
And if they didn't finish, is that 0?
No. If they started.
No, like didn't finish all the problems.
If they're just blank, then yeah. If it's just blank, then it'd be a 0 for that particular problem.
Wait, can you leave that up there for something?
Yep. I see what you mean.
No, like. He didn't have enough time to do more than just number one. For these ones, as they get some of these are all back.
That's
a lot of windows.
Where's the window that I want?
Go ahead and put up a house.
Excuse me.
There we go.
I know.
Opportunity of me pausing to talk. It's part of a mindset of I'm here to talk to people, and if you're here to learn, you're just ready to go. Okay, so I know it's a difficult thing to just sit there while I figure something out that went nuts with my computer, but try and make it a habit. Just wait patiently if that happens. Anyway, so here we are. We're gonna graph the inputs and outputs of this equation. We know it's going to be a line because we're talking about linear equations. We're making it easier on ourselves here at the early parts of the year. We know it's going to be a line, so we just need to find 2 points. Just 2 points. So, 0 for x would be really easy. 0 for x would be really easy.
Wait.
Yes?
Were we allowed to do rise over run on this one?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
But here's my warning against that. If the only way that you know how to do a line, graph a line, is to do that, the danger is if you forget, if you get the rise and the run mixed up, if you mix up a negative or whatever, like if your understanding of a graph isn't always this graph is a bunch of points, and I know how to find the points, I find the x's and y's for this equation that work in this equation. If you start to move away from that understanding to, or I know the shortcut, then when we come back to graphing later, we're going to graph lots of different functions when we come back later to those functions.
Mm-hmm.
If the foundation is on always, this is a bunch of points and I know how to find those points, even if you use rise over run, it's just fine. It's going to be difficult later.
Okay.
So if you do that, then just keep in the back of your mind the understanding of like how you could explain why that works.
Okay. When we do the rise of the run, if it's like next to an x, like a fraction next to an x. So we can't do it, so it's like y.
X equals negative 3/5 y plus 4?
No, like if it was y plus 3/5 x equals 4.
It needs to be, in order to do the slope intercept form, the rise of the run, it needs to be y equals mx plus b. It's got to look like that.
Alright.
Okay. So. And what we're doing by plugging in 0 here really is what Drew's talking about. We're just kind of going into a little bit more detail about what the shortcut is actually doing. Okay? So what that shortcut is doing is finding the y-intercept, and that's what we're about to do right now by plugging in 0 for x, the easiest value of x to plug in. What do we do, or what do we get when we plug in 0 for x?
0.
And what do we get for y? Like what is y equal to then? 4. 0 plus 4. 4. So if you're doing the slope-intercept form, you're doing rise over run and the y-intercept, you immediately put a point at 4, right? Why? Because if you plug in 0 for x, you'll get 4 for y. That's why. That's how come. Alright. Okay, let's follow the slope from here. That would be, depending on how you look at it, because it's negative, either go to the right 5 and down 3, or go to the left 5 and up 3. It doesn't matter. I mean, look at those points. They're on a line, right? So it doesn't matter. Like, it makes the same line. Whether we go down 3 to the right 5 or up 3 to the left 5, it's going to be the same line.
What if they just did the graph and then show it worked?
this work? If this graph winds up looking correct, that's fine. Okay. Well, how can I find those points so easily? How do I know that those points are going to be there? Well, because if I go to x is, what is this x right here?
Five.
If I go to five,
five.
That's going to be after zero, the next easiest thing to plug in for x because it cancels out the denominator. Because the 5's cancel, we get negative 3 plus 4. That's 1. 5 comma 1. Which is the same thing as going down 3 and over 5. If I start at 4 and go down 3, start at 4 and subtract 3, then I come down to 1. Come down to 1. That happens when I go over to x is 5. Now, if you just plot that point right there and come down 3 and over 5 and plot that point and connect it, then you have the right graph. I can't. If I say please graph this and you graph it, I can't hardly hold that against you if you draw the correct graph, right?
No, you cannot.
I cannot. So, unless I ask for something else, if you have drawn the graph correctly, then you got the question right. Later when we're graphing parabolas and all that kind of stuff, polynomials, then it's going to be so much easier on ourselves. From now on, or even from before, we've been thinking of these graphs as an infinite number of points that we find by finding the solutions to this equation, finding an x and a y that make the equation true. Right? Here's a couple of them. 0 for x and 4 for y, that'll be true. And we have 4 over here, and that'll be 4. 5 for x and 1 for y, but 5 there. Comes out to 1. Y is 1. The equation is true. It's solved. Any questions about that one? And if you want to do the y-intercept of the slope, that's great. But don't lose sight of what a graph is, the definition of a graph.
Don't lose sight of what's really important.
That's right.
Okay.
And that's because a graph is an infinite number of points. It's the most important thing in life. Remember.
Except for Twitter.
Twitter's the most important thing?
No.
Obviously.
Alright. Sketch a graph for the given domain. Alright. If you have, which you should have an idea, but if you had no idea what this meant, you just kind of ignored this, you'd be like, what you'd actually be doing is like drawing too much of the graph. You'd be doing too much work. This part of it just means we're not going to draw the whole line. We're going to just draw some of the line.
Okay.
And we'll do it. We'll do like we're gonna graph the whole line, and then I'll show you which part of the line we weren't supposed to graph because we're supposed to pay attention to this. All right. So let's just graph this line. How would that go if we're doing this? The slope and the y-intercept go down to y is negative 5. The slope is 7/3, so I go up 7 and over 3. But like I said, essentially I've graphed too much of this graph, drawn too much of the line. I was supposed to not do all of it. The only parts I was supposed to graph were those parts.
Oh,
sounds so disgusting.
Yeah.
Disgusting.
The only part that I was supposed to graph was for the x values that are bigger than or equal to negative 3. My graph goes forever. It's supposed to stop at negative 3 and go bigger than that. Okay. So, I mean, if you think of it, like, let's look on the x-axis. Negative 3 is right here. Okay. Just going to draw an imaginary dotted line. It's dotted to show you that it's not like, those aren't the points we're talking about being solutions to the equation. And we're supposed to going to pretend this stuff doesn't exist. Don't think about any x that's less than negative 3. We're supposed to look at negative 3 and larger. So But my graph that I've drawn really just keeps on going and going and going and going. That's not what I was supposed to do. Once I get to an x of -3, I just forget about any part of the graph that's to the left of that or exists for an x that's less than -3. So let's go to x is -3, see what y value we get. Y equals 7/3 times -3 minus 5. We get -7 minus 5, so -12. So this guy right here, if I put that dot right there, that's at -3, -12. If I go to x is -3, I get a y of -12. Of course, that's what that point represents. It represents if I put in this for x, I get out that for y. Looks like that. 100% correct. What if, though, what if I get rid of that?
It's greater than
so
negative.
Only greater. And not equal to -3. How would that change the graph? Yes?
You couldn't have it stop at -3. You'd have to have it stop at -2.
What about -2.5?
Yeah, well, negative. Couldn't have it stop at -3.
Yeah, somehow we have to show that it stops just before -3, but it's okay for it to be -2.9 and -2.999 and negative, and so on, right? So how do we show that? Can you tell me that, Dimitri?
We erase it to the
wow, it's kind of a tricky thing, huh?
Yeah, because you can't really, well, you can never really show it, because, you know.
Yeah, exactly, we can't actually show it. We have to kind of use a symbol to represent it, that it doesn't ever let x be -3. Do you have an idea?
That makes sense. Say that the dot is right before -3.
That's hard to know, like, I should be able to just look at the picture and know that that's what you mean. Okay, so instead of a key, here's the key that we would use. We would put an open circle. Not a filled in dot, but an open one. Have you seen that before?
Yeah.
On a number line?
Uh-huh.
Right, if you have a really simple inequality like x is bigger than 4, and you draw your number line like this,
yes.
0, 1, 2, 3, 4.
So remember.
And okay, we want to have numbers that are bigger than 4, but it can't be equal to 4, so we put an open circle. Same thing here. Open circle tells me that x can never actually be -3, but it can be -2.9999 as many nines as I want. As close to -3 as I want to get, but not actually get to -3. That's the open circle. Like you said, it would be a hard thing to show. Like, actually show on the graph and have somebody just look at it and be like, yeah, that line doesn't quite get to -3. How could you show that? I can zoom in forever and never see the gap between this line and x is -3. I can just get as close as I want to get. I'll never see a gap there. So to show that there is, like, a gap or that you can't get to -3, we just use an open circle. Find the x and y intercepts of the graph function. The x and y intercepts are just the point of the x axis where it intercepts and the point of the y axis where it intercepts. I don't have to graph it, but the y intercept is just the point on the y axis that the line touches. And the x intercept is just the point on the x axis where it touches. How do I find those places? It's the same as if I were going to graph it.
Plug in 0.
Plug in 0 for x and then find y, and then plug in 0 for y, and find x, and you'll find those two points. So plug in 0 for x, we'll get 6y equals 24, y equals 4. So 0 comma 4. What's that? It's got a special name, that point, though. What is that point called?
I'm
defined. You're thinking of thinking of dividing by zero.
Yeah, never mind.
It's this point right here. Again, they don't have to have a graph. That's not what I asked for.
The y-intercept.
The y-intercept. Yes, the point on the y-axis, the y-intercept.
Okay.
What? You go, girl.
Have I missed anybody?
Many eggs.
Dimitri.
Dimitri, that was good. The idea of a key off to the side was good.
Oh, yeah.
It just wasn't what we wound up using. So then we plug in 0 for y, and 12x equals 24, and x equals 2. So this point, 2 comma 0, is called
x-intercept.
So we need to just say y-intercept and x-intercept. There we go. Those are the y-intercepts. That is the last of the questions. Squared out of 20, and pass it back, and then pass it in. So here we have three different functions. Okay, I'm going to try and sell you on something called function notation, because if I just say, hey, this is how we're going to write functions now, and it looks a little more confusing, you might say, well, why would we trade out what this looks like for something that looks slightly more confusing? Right, it does look a little bit more confusing. It does mix people up sometimes when they first start using it. But I'm going to try to show you why we use it. Okay. So if I stand over here and I say I want you to plug 12 in to the function.
Okay.
Wait,
can I get a
calculator?
What's that? You have a question?
You mean plug 12 into x?
Plug 12 in for x in the function.
On the first
thing? Yes.
Can I get a calculator?
You don't need one. I would say you need one question. Okay, so here's the question. This is what I don't want you to actually do this. I want you to actually ask a question. Each function? Really, the question is which function?
Oh.
I see
the first one.
Yeah. Because there are three different functions, and we don't know which one we're supposed to plug in 12 for. Yes? So, when I say the function, that implies one function, right?
Yes, yes.
Well, which one? So I have to tell you which one. How can I tell you which one I want you to do? Drew?
But are they all the same?
No, they're not all the same.
I thought it was a trick question.
Oh, no, it's not a trick. Like, if I want you to plug it into a particular one, I don't want you to use the wrong one, the one I didn't have in mind, then how do I tell you which one to use?
The one that has a multiple of it, or something?
Oh, like plugging in 12 here would be better than, say, there? Yeah, but we could still plug 12 in here, and I just haven't told you which function. That's a good, like, if it's your choice, that's certainly what you should choose.
Why aren't you telling us which function?
Well, the question is, how could I, if I want you to plug it into one particular function up there, how can I get you to do that?
Circle it.
Okay, I have to come up and I'd have to circle it.
No, you tell us verbally.
Oh. How?
Like, y equals, like.
Oh, I could just say it.
Yeah.
Y equals 3x plus, okay, 9, 7, yeah.
Like the type of function, like the linear.
Oh, all three of those are linear. But that's a good idea. If we had several different kinds, I could tell you which kind to plug it into.
Well, like the last one has a fraction with a T. Is that T? Or is
that is T, yeah, that is a T. So I could say put it in the one with T.
Yeah.
Well, it has T in it instead of X. These are all good ways. Any number of ways we could use. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say find like the easiest one, but in this.
But the premise is it's not your choice, it's mine, right? And so I don't have a way to communicate to you very well, very efficiently, which one. Yeah?
Tell us which one, Mr. Stewart.
That's my question. How do I tell you which one? I'm not holding it against you that you haven't done it. I'm trying to make a point here. If you wanted me to tell you, and imagine that I'm way far away, I can't actually go up to the board. Okay, so I have to tell you from a distance.
The first one or the second one?
Okay, there we go. We start to give them some kind of a designation. That one, the first one, second, third one. Okay? Well, here's the thing, like functions aren't always written in a row. Right? So We wouldn't want to like write. We wouldn't want to write textbooks around like, okay, so look at the top function, look at the middle function, look at the right function, look at the left function. All right. So we're getting there. F.
Number then.
Okay, number then. Function number one. Function number two. Function number three.
Sure.
Like these are all good ideas. These all accomplish what we're trying to accomplish.
Color code them.
Color code them. I could have before this made them different colors.
Letter.
Are you looking for a specific
answer? Oh, I don't think you're gonna come up with the answer. I'm trying to make a point, and then I'll show you how mathematicians have solved this problem.
Okay.
So it's not like we're gonna come up with something, and that's what we'll use, unless you do happen to come up with the right answer.
I don't have two
right answers. None of these answers are wrong. The same one's right is to say that the other one's wrong. That's not true. You have another one here? No.
Oh.
Well,
I like
that.
Huh?
So
bad.
Huh?
Letter.
Letter. Well, that's getting closer.
That's what I was gonna say, but then I thought she said that.
Okay, this is getting closer and closer to what we actually wind up doing. So, here's what we do. Similar to, well, it's not really similar to any of these things. We are going to give them each a distinctive quality. All right, we're going to do that by, instead of using y, we're going to use some other variable.
Oh. Changing the variables?
Yeah, but they're just names for variables, right? It doesn't change anything about how the function works.
There's a t here.
Yeah. I mean, I don't even have to have x, it could be t. But the way we name functions, so that's the first part of it, we're giving functions names. That's the first part of function notation, is we give functions names. Okay, we're going to give them names. Now, here are the typical names we give to functions. Function starts with what letter?
An f.
So we start with f.
F1.
And then we work our way up from there. Okay? So if we want to give these functions names, this is the one that I wrote first, so I'll call it F instead of Y. I'll call this one G, call this one H. If we get, usually I would use I, but you could. There's no reason why you can't put I equals whatever. So now I'm from a distance, I'm going to tell you to plug in 3 into the function f. Now, I'm not saying, when I say plug 3 into f, I don't mean into the variable f. I mean into the function f. Okay,
yes.
Into the function f. The function is named f. I want you to put that into the function. I want you to just put 3 into that function. And x being the typical input, we're going to input that for x.
Won't the cosine be misleading?
The answer would be negative 63.
Because like you said, plug in whatever for f, but wouldn't it be misleading like they actually plug in for f and saying that's a whole equation instead of just
3x.
I'm not sure what you mean.
Like whatever the problem is equals f.
Yeah.
And like you saying plug in for f is like we actually plug in for f. Wouldn't that be misleading with
that
equal sign?
So you're saying that I say the sentence, plug in 3 for f.
Like actually put 3 equals 3.
That's what I'm trying to say. Like I know it sounds funny. It sounds like I'm saying plug it in for the letter f. Now we're gonna start calling functions by names. It's a transition. It's not completely intuitive, but it's something we use so that I can call it something. I'm going to call it f. F is the name of the function. And if I say plug it in for f, I actually mean for the function f. Okay. Into f. So I know, I agree. And I
agree.
I mean, I could say plug in 3, 4, x in the function f. But then it just kind of gets, eventually just gets shorthanded. Like it becomes this, you know what I mean, by shorthand, like we just say things abbreviatedly so like we all agree. Instead of me saying that in for x, in for x, in for x, in for x, every time I say this, like we cut out the in for x part. And when I say in into f, we understand the in for x of f, right? So this is kind of something I have to get used to.
What if there was like negative 7y?
We won't deal with that.
is it gonna be like this for like a while or just
forever
like,
and ever?
Oh.
Yeah.
Forever and ever.
That's we start using function notation.
Bam.
Okay. That's it. Nope.
So like once they get to Z, do they go back to A or like Y?
Is it like double A?
Well, so here's the thing.
Good question.
The reason why we have names for functions is because we might need to use 3, 4, maybe 5 functions in one setting. We're probably not going to need to use 26 functions altogether. You know what I'm saying? We're probably not going to have to use all the letters of the alphabet. Because if I have homework problem number 1, I can use f of x. And if I have homework number problem number 2, I can use f again. Because it's just a different problem. Now, in one problem, if I want to talk about two different functions, I'll call them f and g. Now we don't really want to have to deal with two functions in one setting because we want to work our way up to there. We want to get used to the idea of them having names in the first place.
Yeah.
Okay. So, well, there's a bit more before I can pull up the rest of this. Right. So they have names. That's the first. F is this function right here. The function f is 3x minus 7. That is what the function is, right? It is equal to f, and that is the function. The function is 3x minus 7. The function g is 3/4x plus 4. And the function h is negative 7/9 t plus 5. Okay, just call it t instead of x. It doesn't make any difference.
So if they did these for like a graph, would that still be called the y, like y-intercept, if it was like letter f? Like
that's pretty standard, but you could call it the f-axis if you wanted to.
No, but like, would it still go
on the
like,
y? It still would go vertical.
Okay.
Yeah. It would still be the vertical. There's still only two variables, really. There's still input and there's output. Okay? You guys all right with that?
Yep.
And there's nothing that I can really do about it. It's the way mathematicians talk about functions. Okay?
Yeah.
So we're going to have to learn it and be comfortable with it. They all have names, f, g, and h. And if I had more functions, I'd come up with more names. All right. You good? Okay, there's more to this notation because hey, if we're going to change it up, let's go ahead and change up a few things and get more utility out of it, more usefulness out of it. I'm going to put this parentheses x here, and let me just tell you right now, if I can shout loud enough to shout into your future so that you never forgot what I'm about to say, I would shout that loud, but I know my voice doesn't travel through time, so I'll just go ahead and keep it. We read this f of x and it doesn't mean f times x. It doesn't mean that. Does not mean multiplication. I'm not arguing with you. I know that it looks like multiplication. That's not what it means in this context. Now, different like things that look the same mean different things in different contexts, right? Like how about this? What's this word?
Win.
Are you sure?
One.
Which word is it?
It's win.
Depends on the context.
Yeah, we're like
that scared.
So it reads exactly the same. It's spelled exactly the same, but there's two different words that are spelled this way, wind and wine. Now I have to put it in a sentence for you to understand what it means. The wind was cold.
Okay.
The wine isn't cold. That wouldn't make much sense. Okay. My friend went to wind up the clock. Okay. He didn't go to wind up the clock. That doesn't make any sense. So it's just context. You have to use contextual clues. So, it doesn't mean f times x, it just means, let me tell you what it means. It means that f is the name, and x is the input. On the other side of the equation, you're going to see x's that you plug in for. I tell you to put something in for, like put 3 into the x's of the function called f. Right? So, 2... let's see, it tells you which variable is the input. And that's it. Those are the two things that function notation does. So each of these needs to get exactly that kind of treatment. I'm going to move this over a little bit so I can make room for the of x part. It means g is a function, that's its name. It's a function of x. That means if x changes, the output changes. And now, is this a function of x? Is x the input in this function right here? T is. So it's h of
t.
T. T is the input in this case. All right.
Okay.
So now I can say plug in 4 for g. That means plug forward to x in the function called g. Now I can stand a ways away from it, and I can direct you to do whatever based on their name. Or, if I want to tell you, plug in 4 into g. Plug 4 into g, right?
Okay.
For x. Then I can write it this way. Instead of, like, that's a long sentence. Plug in 4 for the x's of the function named g. You can use math symbols to write that really, really shortly like this. That does not mean g times 4. Remember, it's not multiplication. This is just the input. Here, x is the input, and here, 4. 4 is now the input. 4 is the thing that you would plug into the function. What does this mean? Like, there's no math happening over here. There's no multiplication. There's no division. There's nothing you need to solve for. This is asking you to do something. Find a number. And the number you get is done this way. You plug in 4 for x. That's it. Right? This means go to g, go to the function g, plug in 4 for x, and then do it, find out what that's worth. Well, that'll be 3 plus 4, that's 7. So g of 4 is 7. And you're done. Don't divide by 4 and try to figure out what g is, because that is not at all what we're trying to do. So this says a lot of things in a very small amount of ink, okay? If I plug in 4 for x into the function g, I'll get 7 out as the output. Okay, the y. Yeah?
So how would you graph that?
You just draw a graph like this, and essentially g of x, remember how g of x took the place of y? Right?
Right.
So that's the y value. That's the vertical value. That's the output. So I plugged in 4. Plugged in 4, that's 4 for the input, and I got 7 as the output. So the output is still on the vertical axis, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there. That what we just did represents that 1.4 comma 7.
Okay.
Right. If I wanted to graph this thing, I can treat it the same as y equals 3/4 x plus 4. Just go to 4 on the y-axis, follow the slope up 3 over 4, it would be the exact same thing. The graph would look exactly the same. Remember, it didn't change anything except for what we call the functions. We don't call them y equals blah, blah, blah. We call g of x equals, or f of x equals, or h of t equals. So here's what I want you to do. I'm going to get rid of this so I can make room. I want you to find these things. And I've made it, the numbers nice to plug in, okay? Just if you're aware. Those are three different numbers I want you to find. One you use the function f, the other you use the function g, the other you use the function h. And they're all right there.
Okay?
All right, see a lot of successful substitutions going on? All right, so remember, f of 3 doesn't mean f times 3. When I solve for f, I'm trying to figure out what f is. F is just the name of the function. And this f of 3 is just telling me, plug in 3 for x in the function f. And then when you do that, when you'll be done, you don't need to solve for anything. So, 3 times the thing I'm plugging in, well, that would be 3, right? That goes into the function. Minus 7, that's 2. 9 minus 7 is 2. All right, I'm going to plug 12 into what? Into g. So I'm going to plug 12 there. 3/4 times 12. 12 over 1. 4 cancels 12. That leaves us with 3 times 3. And then we add 4. 9 plus 4, 13. And 18, we're going to plug 18 into h. We're going to plug it in for t in the function h. So that's negative 7/9 times 18 over 1 plus 5. Cancel 18, I've got 2. Negative 7 times 2. It's negative 14 plus 5, negative 9. Yeah, negative 9. 9's and negatives are 11. And negative, yeah, that stuff misses. All right. have did it. Like you are, you're much closer to understanding function notation. What?
You did.
That's good. All right. Let's see what we have next. We have clocks. Okay. So we want to talk about just some like language, like some. If you're heavy into function culture, then you're gonna know the words, the lingo that people use. Okay. So you might hear people on the streets, they say things like F is a function of X. Okay. That just means that X is the input and F is like kind of the name of the output. Okay. F is a function that you know the value of by plugging something in for X.
So F is Y.
Yeah, F is like Y. F is exactly Y. Alright, okay. But you might hear him say things like the value of the function is blank. Or let's see, the function is worth blank. Okay. When you hear the function is like a number, is like if I say the value of the function is 10, or the function has a worth of 17, where does that play in? Like 10 and 17, what does that have to do with the function? Kind of a hard question, Dimitri.
Output?
Exactly. It's the output. That's exactly what it means. It's the output. Okay. It's the output. It just means the output of the function is. And if you think about it, a function is a thing that exists to turn input into output. Right? So its worth or its value is to make outputs. So once it made that output, then that's the value, that's worth, that is what it is worth. Right? So if we go over here, the value of the function at x equals 3, the value of the function f at x equals 3 is 2. The value of the function g is 13 when x is 12. The value of h is negative 9 when x is 18. Okay? I want you to, like, you're going to hear that and it. If I didn't tell you exactly what it meant, you would be left kind of figure out. So do you hear the value is worth, or the value of the function is, or the function has a value of, or whatever? It just means the output. So I'll just put, say, the output. The output. And we'll have to stop there. I'll have a few more problems that I'll send out to you. Thank you very much.